Our speaker for today is Dr. Pallavi Meshram, or Dr. Pallavi Godghate, as which is also known as. He's a renowned anesthesiologist from Nagpur. Dr. Pallavi has completed her graduation from GMC Nagpur and has done her post-graduation from BJMC Pune. She also holds an Indian diploma in internal care medicine. And at present, she is working as an assistant professor at Government Dental College, Nagpur, in the Department of Oral Surgery. I welcome you, Dr. Pallavi. Please start the presentation.
Yeah. Thank you. Today's topic is anesthesia for maxillofacial surgeries. And at the outset, I thank Dr. Shenoy and Dr. Manika Madam, who has given me an opportunity to interact with you. And at the outset also, I want to tell, as it is very vast topic, and I try to make it as comprehensive, and I haven't gone too much into technicalities, as this is mainly for our residents who are exam going. So I've tried to be as concise and as informative as possible. So, just very brief about the historical aspect and the what do you mean by balance anesthesia. As in the early, as Madam has said, in past when the nitrous oxide was first used, and that was not adequate enough for patients to undergo surgery, which was a patient had a very much agonizing experience. So nowadays the anesthesia is very much advanced, and it is a balanced anesthesia, that is, which consists of the unconsciousness and lack of pain, lack loss of memory of that event. Then the it also includes the attenuation of autonomic response to a noxious stimuli, and it also includes immobility. As Goodell has described the different stage of anesthesia, that is stage of analgesia, delirium, surgical anesthesia, and medullary paralysis. These stages we seldomly see nowadays because of the advanced anesthesia techniques. So what are the indications of anesthesia in maxillofacial surgeries? The most common is trauma, then infections, then cancer patients, the oral maxillofacial cancers. Then in our department, we do have many surgeries which are done as aesthetic facial surgeries or orthognathic surgeries. And also corrective surgeries can be done for severe obstructive sleep apneas. Then TMJ pathology like ankylosis, which is very much common in our department. Then dental extraction, which is also one other commoner in the pediatric population especially, or in patients who are mentally retarded. Then salivary gland surgeries, and of course the cleft and lip surgeries with other syndromic involvement. So why this maxillofacial anesthesia is a specialty anesthetic technique? Because these are the special populations, like patient with polytrauma, which can have head injuries, or patients, or pediatric patients which are having other syndromic implications of other organ systems. Then there's the sharing of airway passages with surgeons, of course. Then there are high chances of incidences of difficult intubations, like in polytrauma patients or in a TMJ and ankylosis patients. Then high incidence of bleeding, and the special technique, that is hypotensive anesthesia, we advocate in these kind of patients to minimize blood loss and for better surgical fit. And of course, the special post-operative complications like obstructions, respiratory, AV obstruction, and post-op nausea vomiting is also very common in these patients. So what are different anesthetic techniques? That is, one is the topical local infiltration and regional procs, which are usually done by surgeons with different local anesthetic agents. Then conscious sedation, which to be done with the presence of anesthetist, that can have inhalation sedation or intravenous sedation. So these conscious sedation means the patient will have some clouding of consciousness, but patient is arousable to some verbal or tactile stimulation, and patient is able to maintain his vital functions, that is respiration and cardiovascular function. And also patient is able to maintain the protective airway reflexes. And of course, general anesthesia with major maxillofacial surgeries. So before going into general anesthesia, very briefly about the preoperative evaluation, which is briefly, but it is very important. So as to ensure a patient if it is in an optimal condition. And if the patient is not in optimal condition, say for example his blood pressures are not normal or his sugars are erratic, or he's on some drugs. Hello. Hello.
I think you can continue for this.
Yeah. So for this optimization, we need to evaluate patient, and also evaluation of the all major other organ system. Especially cardiovascular and cardiorespiratory system, which is having profound effects on their physiology because of anesthesia. So what we get to know after PAC, we get to have some patient doctor rapport. Then we get the patient's data, like his lab parameters or his vital parameters. Then we can formulate an aesthetic plan, and of course we can get the patient's consent, that is the informed written consent, either by patient or by his guardian or his parents if it is the patient is minor. So PAC consists of history taking, physical examination, investigations, and risk trust stratification, that is American Society of Anesthesiology grading. History taking, all we know what to ask for presenting complaints, then history of certain systemic illnesses like hypertension, diabetic, ischemic heart disease, TB, asthma, COPD, etc. Then history of recent URTI, that is viral infection, fever or respiratory tract infection, which is more, in fact, which is much more relevant in today's, these days scenario. Then the history of any previous bad anesthetic history, like difficult intubation or allergy or history of any malignant hypothermia. Then patient's current drug history, any significant family history, and patient's drug addiction, that is if the patient consumes alcohol or tobacco, like that. And it includes also physical examination, like general vital, patient's vital, that is pulse, BP, respiration, and other general examination, that thalamic, wrist clubbing, etc. Then pertaining to cardiovascular and respiratory system, we need to go into details. And of course, neurological system, we need to examine. The patients we are seeing is a polytrauma patient. A special emphasis to be given on the airway assessment, that is how it is done. We need to see a mouth opening, malimplatty classification, to see a neck mobility and other parameters like thyrometal distance or mentohyoid distance or sternomento distance. If we are seeing obviously the signs of difficult intubation, then we need to assess all these things also. Then we need to see the temporomandibular joint mobility, that is upper lip bite test, so that the mandibular protrusion test. And of course, on the direct laryngoscopy, we can get the view, that is Cormac and Lehaner classification. So this is the how the malimpatty classification is done. We can see the pharyngeal structure nicely in class 1. And there's no structure visible, only heart palate is visible in class 4. So increasing the grade will tell you the increasing difficulty of intubation. And the Cormac and Lehaner, we can see a perfect glottic opening with epiglottis in class 1. And grade 4, we don't get any, we don't get even epiglottis to be seen. So again, a difficulty in intubation. The same thing we have told earlier. So other predictors, the eyeballing predictors like limiting mouth opening, or patient do have a neck bone contractures, micrognathia, microglossia, short neck, obesity, protruding teeth. If these things we see in patients, then we predict the intubation might be difficult. So we should be prepared in advance. Other many scoring systems are also used. This is one Wilson score, which includes weight, head neck movements, jaw movement, receding mandibles, and buccties. So depending on the scoring and the scores, the difficult intubation is predicted. Further evaluation can be done by indirect laryngoscopy. Many times we advise it by ENT surgeons, especially if there's a big neck mask and the deviated trachea we are suspecting. We can do fiber optic laryngoscopy. We can do extracervical spine lateral view if we suspect the tracheal deviations. X-ray chest and also can be done. Then the other imaging techniques, like in cancer patient or oral infection, abscesses, patient and post-radiation patients, we can go for MRI and CT scan for evaluation of the patient's airway. And in addition to the physical examination, we need to go for certain investigations. The basic, the patient is young, we go for only CBC, HB, and blood sugar profile and urine routine. But as the patient's age in advance and other systemic illnesses coexist, then we need to do many more tests like kidney function test, LFT, coagulation, X-ray, ECE code to evaluate patient cardiovascular system, and lung function test and ABG if the respiratory system is compromised. So depending upon the history physical examination, we have we assigned the patient to different ASA physical status classification. So ASA 1 to ASA 5, if the grading is increases, then the mortality risk is also increased. That taking ASA 1, if this patient is perfectly healthy, mortality is very low. ASA 2, if the mild systemic illness, mortality is also very low. In ASA 3 grade, where the severe systemic illness, which limits the daily activity, mortality is much more, that is up to 4%. In ASA 4, if the severe systemic illness is very much incapacitating, then the mortality is up to 23%. And of course, ASA 5, the patient is moribund, the mortality is up to 50%. And the risk is also, the mortality is also increased if the surgery performed is the emergency surgery. So we assign those patients as ASA 1E or ASA 4E depending upon the emergency. Other risk, cardiac risk index we can assess. One is the ASA grading, then other risk indexes which can predict the other cardiovascular adverse event perioperatively. So depending upon the risk factors, if the risk factors are more, the major or the major cardiovascular adverse events also increase. Different systems are there. Other is the functional capacity, which will be measured in terms of metabolic requirements, which is very much like the resident can get an idea if the patient can do household activity or the patient can have a strenuous activity. So depending upon the increase in the METs, what is MET is the metabolic equivalent. That is, one metabolic equivalent is equal to 3.5 ml of O2 consumption per kg per minute. If the patient can consume oxygen on a higher metabolic equivalent, then patient do have less risk of the adverse cardiovascular event. So now we have assigned the patient we have examined a patient, we have investigated, we have done the consent and risk stratification. Now what preoperative instruction we will give the patients? So as earlier thought of, the strict NBM 6 hours or 8 hours, it is not like that these days. We can have small sips of water up to 2 hours of the surgery. Certain medications to be continued, like antihypertensive medications to be continued, except the ACE inhibitors or the angiotensin receptor blockers or diuretics, which can cause the hypotension intraoperatively. Cardiac medications, like beta blockers or digoxin to be continued. Certain antidepressant, anxiolytics, and other psychiatric medication, if patient is on, then we need to look for the drug interactions. Say if patient is on a myo-inhibitors and we, in the maxillofacial surgery, we do give, tend to give adrenaline infiltrations that can have severe hypertension and tachycardia MAO inhibitors do tend to increase the catecholamine concentration. If the patient do have on SSRI, that is selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, then they do have interaction with our opioids like pethidine or tramadol that can have a central serotonin syndromes and many interactions. The patient need to continue thyroid medications and other reflux medication, heartburn medication, or anticonvulsants, or asthma medications. Some more thing about the aspirin and the antiplatelet agents, which are to be aspirin to be discontinued at least 3 days before surgery, and other thienopyridines, that is clopidogrel and teclopidine, these are to be discontinued at least 7 days prior to surgery, and teclopidine 14 days prior to surgery. Only thing, if the patient is having drug-eluting stent or the coronary stents, and that these things are to be continued for 12 months. So we need to weigh the risk of stopping these drugs and the risk of surgery. Medication that are to be discontinued, mostly the oral hypoglycemic agents, diuretics, as I have said, sildenafil and warfarin. And if the patient needs a warfarin, then those are to be discontinued, and those are to be shifted on the low molecular weight heparins or heparins. So these are NPO guidelines. So as we can see, the clear liquids we can take up to 2 hours, and breast milk up to 4 hours, and solid foods at least 8 hour fasting. So what are the standard basic monitoring equipments we need? These are the AESA standards. One is the first and foremost is the presence of qualified anesthesia personnel in the room throughout the conduct of anesthesia. Then we need to monitor the vital functions like oxygenation, circulation, and ventilation. For these, we need to have a gas monitor, and which is very mandatory. To see for the inspired oxygen concentration, we can use these oxygen analyzers with low oxygen pressure alarms to be there. That is very mandatory. Then we need to see for a pulse oximeter, which is also a mandatory monitor. Then for circulation, we should have and must have blood pressure monitoring and ECG monitoring, which is to continuous. Then for ventilation, end-tidal CO2 is must. And this spirometry, if it is there, is very desirable. We can see for the expiratory tidal volumes, and which will tell us about any accidental disconnections. And temperature monitoring is also desirable. So what are the pre-medications? Pre-medications, as you all know, that is antacid, then aspiration prophylaxis, that is H2 blockers or proton pump blockers or prokinetics, anti-thalagogues, glycopyrrolate, atropine can be given, especially if you are planning for the awake fiber optic intubation, because secretions, patients tend to have secretions, or if we are using ketamine as in pediatric patient, then these anti-thalagogues are important to those patients. Then vagolytics to avoid the bradycardia. If many a times this vasovagal happens because a patient is in a lighter plane of anesthesia, then these pre-medicated vagolytics, especially in awake fiber optic intubation, these are very important. Anxiolytics like benzodiazepines, then other sedatives can also be given, and analgesic, that is opioid or NSAIDs, or combination of both. Especially in perioperative period, we tend to give combination of opioid and NSAIDs. Dr. So
Pallavi,
a little more.
I'm Dr. Shenoy speaking.
There
are a few questions which we may take later, but there is one thing that I want to ask, because the questions are piling up on my side.
Okay.
The question from Dr. Sharan is, can in extraoral procedures, right, short cases, can they be carried out with short GA without intubation?
Yeah, extraoral procedures, if there is no risk of aspiration, if you are doing it on the neck or, you know, externally some lump or something, and risk of aspiration is not there, we can of course carry it out under short GA, or of course under sedation also.
Okay.
Now sedation with your blocks.
Okay. Now, since we have interrupted you, can you take questions now, or you plan to take them at the end?
No issues. I mean, if we want to ask whatever I have covered, if you want to ask on that.
I have forwarded a few questions. We can, because I think questions are going to come quite a lot.
Rajeshri, you can
ask her the questions.
Ma'am, there's somebody who wants to know how protruding teeth suggests difficulty in intubation.
As the protruding teeth, as we are doing laryngoscopy, the maneuvering of the laryngoscope is difficult with the protruding teeth, and the space available, because the maneuvering is difficult, the space available in intraorally because the how we tend to displace the tongue, or how we, as we need to give the pressure forward and perpendicular to the patient's chest, the laryngoscopic maneuvering is difficult. And because of that, the tongue displacement will be difficult, and the visualization of the glottic opening will be difficult, and putting tube will be difficult at that time.
I think that is why it leads to a lot of times a mobility on the anterior teeth while they are protruding.
Yeah, and of course the trauma and all that, then risk of the foreign body, like the teeth, many times teeth can go inside because of the marrying, the lower teeth or upper teeth also, they do get, tend to get displaced at times, or a traumatic avulsion can happen.
Right, ma'am, there's another question. Why NSAIDs are discontinued 48 hours prior to the induction?
If NSAIDs, if these do have the antiplatelet action, so even if we are doing these complete blood count, and if the platelet, the NSAIDs do have, they don't have the quantitative defect, but the qualitative defect in the platelets. That is the platelet adhesion and aggregation is inhibited. So if these NSAIDs are, say, if these are aspirin like agents, then these are to be better avoided. Rest of the, it's not a general statement, but actually if pertaining to aspirin, if other things like, we tend to give NSAIDs like diclofenac or ketorolac, these things, that can be given. Other thing would be the gastritis caused by these agents. If patient do have a nil by mouth status, and if we if these agents do have like side effect as a gastritis, so if, and of course we do give antihistaminics or proton pump inhibitors, but if possible, that is another.
Alpana, can I ask one question? Hello.
Reason for difficult intubation in OMFA?
In our department, mostly the TMJ's ankylosis, one of the reason. Other thing is the trauma patients, especially the mandible or maxillary trauma. If the mandibular fractures are there, then the intubation is really difficult in that case. Other thing, if the many a times we go for a nasal intubation, but if the nasal intubation is contraindicated and there are concomitant fractures of mandibular maxilla, then we need to put tube inside, and then we need to submental intubations. That might get tricky in that situation. And the older population, of course, the edentulous patients or patients who are emaciated or cancerous patients with a limited mouth opening, or the oral submucous fibrosis patients with, when the mouth opening is limited, then these patients tend to have difficulty in intubation in OSM.
Thanks, ma'am. Rama, any more questions?
Yeah, I'll ask one question. Somebody wants to know what is the upper lip test for pre-anesthetic evaluation?
Upper lip bite test is it is for the mobility of the TMJ joint. That is, the patient can bite his upper lip. That means he can protrude his mandible. The one thing, that is mobility of the TMJ joint. Other thing is, when we induce the patient, then because of loss of muscle tone, after induction, when we mass ventilate the patient, those patients tend to have respiratory obstruction because of the maneuver. What we do is the jaw thrust. So if we know that the patient can do that, so that the jaw thrust, we can predict that we can do the jaw thrust and we can maintain the mass ventilation with the jaw thrust, because after induction we need to oxygenate the patient for a certain amount of time till the patient do have the muscle paralysis for intubation to be done.
I think you can go ahead.
Yeah,
there are a few questions which we'll ask later, because I think you will address them later.
Okay, sir. Something more detailed about benzodiazepine, because we tend to use it day in, day out. So it is GABA facilitatory and have anxiety, amnesia, sedation, and anticonvulsant property. So most commonly used is midazolam, which is short acting, which is having a inhalation half of 1 to 4 hours. So for short procedures, daycare procedures, for sedations, we can use it. Lorazepam and diazepam are little long acting. So we are expecting the surgery to be long, then we can
use.
So benzodiazepines can use as a in sedative dose. As an inducing agent, but which is less commonly used as an inducing agent, and also for a continuous sedation if we are planning for TEVA. But even the midazolam is not very much advocated. Earlier days we used to give midazolam, especially the midazolam these days is used in the ICU sedation, not for the TEVA. So the side effects of midazolam is it can have decrease in the systemic vascular resistance, that can have hypotension and also respiratory depression, and which is much more augmented if these benzodiazepines are used along with the narcotics or the opioids. So we need to be vigilant enough if we are using midazolam and the narcotics side by side. Other sedatives, those can be used in addition to these. Especially these can be used if we are doing it under sedation. So if the patient we are giving midazolam, and if the patient is not sedated and we don't want to go further on the doses of midazolam or the benzodiazepines and the opioid, then we can go for another group of drugs, that is H1 blockers, that is these Phenagon or these Benadryl injectables, or oral, of course, these can be given to augment the sedation. Then the hyoscine, the anticholinergic, these do have the sedative property. Then other drugs which are used are central alpha 2 agonist, clonidine and metronidazole. Clonidine can also be given as an oral preparation to help in the sedation. And other drugs like haloperidol can also be used as a sedative agent, especially in the in MAG, that is monitored anesthesia care, which are the patients we do under sedation. And then the analgesic agent as a premedication, of course the opioids we are using these days, and opioids are much, the newer opioids, these are much more lipid soluble and much more cardiostable, like fentanyl. These are used as analgesic doses or induction doses. Analgesic doses are 1 to 2 microgram per kg, and inducing doses, especially the cardiovascular surgeries, when patients, or other surgeries also, if the patient's cardiovascular status is very bad, say his ejection fractions are bad, his valves are not working properly, then especially opioid induction is done. Higher doses of opioids are to be used, that is 20 to 50 microgram per kg, and opioids are also used for the TEVA, that is total intravenous anesthesia, for maintenance of anesthesia in a dose of 1 to 2 microgram per kg per hour. Special pumps are also available for these. The syringe pumps are also available for to provide the maintenance of anesthesia with fentanyl. Another newer form of opioid is the remifentanil, which I have not included because it is not available right now in our setup. Remifentanil is also very short acting opioid, and after discontinuation, the discontinuation of the infusion, the effect won't last much long, so the patient can be extubated then itself without much after effects of the opioids, sedation and respiratory depression. Then other opioids which we are commonly use is tramadol and pentazocine. These are having lesser respiratory depression, which can be used in the local anesthesia procedures or the MAC procedures. The non-opioid analgesics, like what we tend to use is diclofenac or ketorolac or paracetamol. And of course, it should be a multimodal analgesia approach. That is, non-opioid NSAIDs tend to have some anti-inflammatory actions. So they tend to decrease the inflammation, edema along with that. And the opioids do have these, because of the opioid receptors, it's acton, it would aid into the analgesia. Now, something about the prophylactic antibiotics, that is in maxillofacial surgery particularly, we tend to give these BL-BLI combination, that is the beta-lactamase and beta-lactamase inhibitor combination. So most commonly what we are using is amoxicillin and clamlinic acid. Other thing what we can use is ampicillin and sulbactam, and ceftriaxone also. Cephalosporins can also be used. Other drugs like quinolones and clarithromycin, azithromycin can also be used if the patients are allergic to beta-lactams. We tend to go for anaerobic coverage like metronidazole or clindamycin can also be added if we are seeing any infective pathology in, say, in abscesses or osteomyelitis. Then we tend to include the anaerobic coverage also. And depending upon the patients, the local flora and all, we tend to add on the gram-negative coverage as well. So now we have done the pre-anesthetic checkup and pre-anesthetic medication. This is the patient has come to OT after the written informed consent. So this is the anesthesia workstation we must be all aware of. And as we are expecting our intubation to be difficult, this is difficult in airway cart. We tend to have different sizes of tubes, different sizes of laryngoscopes. Is also to be available. We do have fiber optic scope in our department. So for these TMJs patients or oral submucous fibrosis, we use fiber optics scope as a as aid for difficult intubation. So now the induction agent. So certain properties of ideal inducing agent. What we are using, the most commonly used is propofol. That is why it's not ideal, but it is almost ideal to the ideal inducing agent. It is having rapid onset and offset of action. It depresses upper airways, so it facilitates the intubation. It is having bronchodilator action also. It is having antiemetic effect also. And it is having some extra hepatic metabolism also. So hepatic and extra hepatic. So it can be, safely can be given renal dysfunction. And it is having some cerebral protective effect. That is, it decreases intracranial pressure, intraocular pressures. And it is having anticonvulsant effect as well. So the doses are, induction doses are 1.5 to 2.5 milligram per kg. It can be used as a sedative agent, 25 to 100 microgram per kg per minute. And it also can be used as a maintenance of anesthesia, that is 100 to 300 microgram per kg per minute, that is the dose. Side effects are also there, that is, as it is cardiodepressant, it can have bradycardia, hypertension. It tend to decrease the systemic vascular resistance, so hypertension. And prolong propofol infusion syndrome, that is, lactic acidosis, which is observed especially in children. After prolonged infusion, then it's emulsion, so it do have pain in injection, pain on injection, and it don't have any preservative. So the propofol, the vial once open or the syringe loaded should be used within six hours, because it otherwise it will have the bacterial growth. Other agent what we use is ketamine. It is NMDA antagonist. It do have analgesic property also. The patient tend to have a dissociative anesthesia. It can be given IV, oral, intramuscular, per rectal, intrathecal, various. It is also short acting. So it is analgesic. What are the advantages of ketamine? It is analgesic, bronchodilator. Yeah, the ventilator depressant effect is less with ketamine. It tend to maintain the airway reflexes intact, and it also stimulates the sympathetic system. So it tend to increase heart rate and blood pressure. So it is very much useful in a patient with a trauma, whether the blood pressures are borderline, so that the blood pressures are maintained with ketamine. But we do have some side effects like increasing secretions. Tend to increase intracranial pressure, And other side effect of ketamine is emergence delirium. That is, patient can have various dysphoric symptoms. Patient can be confused, hallucinating. And that can be avoided by pre-treatment with the benzodiazepines. So the induction dose is 1 to 2 milligram per kg IV. And sedative dose is 3 to 7 milligram per kg IM. That can be act as sedative agent, or the intramuscular induction can also be done with ketamine, especially in the children. If they are small children, if they are having the OT anxiety and if they are crying, then we can't get the intravascular access. Then we can put the ketamine intramuscular, and then patient can have a dissociative anesthesia. Then we can put intravenous line, and things can be proceed further. We can give it as an anesthetic analgesic dose only, in addition to the sedative agents we can use, of course, with the monitored anesthesia care. Other agent is etomidate, though we are not using it very much in our department, but the advantage of etomidate is it is having stable cardiovascular profile. So again, if the patient is having unstable cardiovascular status, that is the heart is bad, that is LV is bad, ejection fraction is low, and if the patient is having hypertension because of, say, hypovolemia, and we are ongoingly doing resuscitation, and if you want to put it intubate the patient, this can be safely done with etomidate because the cardiovascular stability is maintained. The problem with etomidate is it tend to suppress the adrenocortical axis, so it can be suppressed till 24 hours. So if the patient is compromised, we need to give the steroid supplementation for that much of period. And the barbiturates, which is age old and well tested. These days, of course, now the NSAIDs are not very much using the thiazide sodium, though it is having its own advantages. Like it is, the action is GABA potentiating, it is short acting, it is cerebroprotective, anticonvulsant. Problem with the thiazide is it can cause tachycardia, hypotension, respiratory depression, bronchospasm. It can precipitate porphyria in those patient population. Then it is having antalgesic effect, and it can cause histamine release and subsequent hypotension. Other problem with thiazide sodium is if there is a accidental intra-arterial injection, then that can cause the crystal formation of the thiazide sodium, because they tend to get precipitated and the crystal blocks the arteries, and that can have ischemia and because of the vasospasm. So these are the the IV induction agent, and the other induction agent could be inhalation induction agent. If take second, just a second. So, inhalation induction, indications of inhalation induction would be difficult intubation, or in pediatric population where IV access is not easily patient is having upper or lower airway obstruction, and if the foreign body is there, then we should not lose the patient's airway or patient's respiratory like patient's breathing or ventilatory capacity, because in these patients the intubation could be difficult. And if the IV induction agent, if we give, and if patient is respiratory depressed, then patient can have the life-threatening hypoxia. So inhalation induction, once we put them on, then they come under anesthesia, and if we turn off the inhalation agent, then patient rapidly the anesthesia is reversed. So in a difficult intubation or airway obstruction, this is used. The popular agents which we use is sevoflurane, halothane, ether, along with nitrous oxide. So why these only agents are used? Because they are having good smell, not a pungent smell. They are non-irritant, and especially the sevoflurane do have low blood gas solubility coefficient, so that tend to have a rapid induction and rapid recovery. other agents, what is halothane, though it is having the high blood gas solubility coefficient, it tend to have prolonged effect because it is more lipid soluble. But as it is, the induction is smoother with halothane, we also use halothane as a inducing agent. So what is the technique what we use as an inhalational induction? Two techniques. One is the tidal volume induction, that is the mask is put on the patient's face and gradually the mask with oxygen, of course, and gradually we tend to increase the inhalation agent. That is, say if we are, I'm using sevoflurane, then I will tend to increase the concentration from say 1-2% to up to 6%. And as the concentration increases, the patient tend to go under anesthesia. Then other thing is vital capacity induction, where the patient is, of course, the cooperative. So the patient exhales to a residual volume and take the full vital capacity breath. That is, he takes a deep inspiration. And high concentration of, that is 8% sevoflurane, is used for this vital capacity induction. And then patient comes under anesthesia. That is, we can see the corneal reflexes or patient's tone and the opening of the mouth. Then we can intubate these patients. And the inhalational induction can be augmented. The time can be augmented with concomitant use of NTO. That is nitrous oxide, which is having its own advantages. That is, it can have a concentrating effect and the second gas effect. Now, these are little technical things, but just to remember that if the inhalation agent is less soluble in blood, then more will be available to alveoli. So the alveolar partial pressure will be increased of the inhaled anesthetic agent. And if the alveolar partial pressure is increased, then this partial pressure is reflected in the brain. So it is not the amount of the inhalation agent which is present in the brain which matters to the anesthesia, but the partial pressure which is we are achieving in the brain, that tells you about the induction. So if the agent is less soluble in blood, then it tends to have a rapid induction. So if the inhalation agents with having lower max, these are more potent, but higher max, they tend to have a low solubility and tend to have a rapid induction of inhalational induction. Now, the inhalational induction, we can intubate the patient, but what about afterwards? Because we can't give the sevoflurane, say, for example, 6% throughout the surgical procedure. Or after the IV induction, we need to have muscle relaxant for the optimum intubating conditions. So muscle relaxants are used. There are two types. One is depolarizing, that is succinylcholine, what we commonly use, and other is the non-depolarizing, that is the long-acting, what we commonly call these are. So succinylcholine is depolarizing muscle relaxant because it causes muscles to contract. That is, we can see the fasciculations, which is very short-acting. The onset of action is within 30 to 60 seconds. And intubating condition, we can get optimum intubating condition in 60 to 90 seconds. And we can intubate the patient within that time. And there is but that is a rapid offset of action because of the pseudocholine receptors which are present in the plasma. So because of the rapid offset, we need to give the muscle relaxants which are long acting after the succinylcholine. The problem with succinylcholine is it can have increase in intracranial, intragastric, and intraocular pressure. So we can't give it in patient with head injuries. We can't give patients with perforating or eye injuries, or we can't give it these patients with who are having gastroesophageal reflux disease. So we can use other muscle relaxant in these patients. Then the patient can succinylcholine can have hyperkalemia, especially if the patient is having chronic kidney problems, or patient do have some myopathies or burns. These patients tend to release the potassium from the injured muscles, and patient can have life-threatening hyperkalemia. So this is to be avoided in these kind of patients. Then because of the fasciculation, patient can have post-operative myalgias because of succinylcholine. Then it can cause arrhythmias. It is not very cardiostable agent. Then one very important side effect is malignant hyperthermia. Though it is very uncommon, but yes, it can happen. Along with the inhalational agent and succinylcholine, these malignant hyperthermia can happen in patients under anesthesia. So patient can have trismus or increased muscle tone. Patient can have increased end-tidal CO2s. Patient can have tachycardia, hypertension, or followed by bradycardia and hypotension, hyperkalemia, metabolic acidosis, all these things. But the drug of choice in these patients is dantrolene sodium. That is, we can give a bolus dose of 2.5 milligram per kg, and then the followed by other boluses of up to 10 milligram per kg till the hyperthermia is reversed. So non-depolarizing muscle relaxation, these are having a competitive block at the neuromuscular junction. That is, they compete with the acetylcholine at the neuromuscular junction, and they block the neurotransmission. So these are either short acting, that is mivacurium. It can act up to 30 minutes. Then intermediate acting, these are most commonly used, that is rocurinium, vecurinium, atracurium. It can act up to 30 to 50 minutes. And acting, that is pancurinium, which acts more than 50 minutes. So after induction and after muscle relaxation, we need to intubate the patient for general anesthesia. So different strategies of intubation can be applied, that is orotracheal, nasotracheal, submental, retromolar intubation, retrograde intubation, fiber optic intubation, depending upon our plan of action. At times, patient need a planned tracheostomy. And if the patient do have difficulty in intubation and things are not available, we need to use the supraglottic devices like LMAs, or as a rescue procedure, we need to do these transtracheal jet ventilation also to maintain the oxygenation and ventilation. So some of the AV devices, these are the preformed tubes, south pole and north pole tubes. South pole tubes are the oral tubes which we use. North pole tubes especially, we use it nasally. Then the armor tubes. Tube which are non-kinkable tube. The upper one is armor tube, which is having wire enforced in the body of the tube, so that the it won't get kinked. So if patient do need the positioning intraoperatively, then the normal tube can get kinked. Or if we need to do a submental intubation, then the armor tube is used. Then different laryngeal mass airways. The first one is the intubating airways. These are very intubating laryngeal mass airways. These are very important if patient is, we need to formulate a plan for a difficult intubation algorithm. These IGELs, see how the supraglottic devices are placed the over the glottis, and then they help to ventilate the patients. Then other aids like lighted wand, these are the blind techniques, or it could be along with the laryngoscopy. If the Cormac-Lehanna classification is on a higher side, that is, if we are not getting the glottic view properly, then we tend to see the glow of the lighted wand, and then we can advance our tube. If we see the glow of the lighted wand on the anterior side of the neck, then video laryngoscope. Again, tube is filled alongside of the scope. We can get the direct visual of the glottic opening. Then of course the fiber optic intubation, especially in anticipated or unanticipated difficult intubation. If the cervical spine is unstable, then the optimal position is not, we can't get the atlanto-occipital flexion or cervical spine, atlanto-occipital extension and cervical spine flexion will be difficult. Then in the neutral position, the intubation can be done with the fiber optic scope. And of course, in airway obstruction, we should intubate the patient with the fiber scope. So some details about awake fiber optic intubation. We need to have some prerequisites for awake fiber optic intubation. Patient should have aspiration prophylaxis, then anticholinergic medication to decrease the secretion. Then we should have the difficult intubation poly ready. And then we should have the nasal decongestant and Otrivin or oximetazoline to be used prior. So how to anesthetize the passages as the patient, our patient is awake. We can use the tropical spray 10% or lignocaine gargles 2%. Nebulization we can use 4%. Then we can give the transtracheal lignocaine through the cricothyroid membrane so that once we pierce the membrane and aspirate for air, then push some 1 or 2 mL of the lignocaine 2%. Then patient coughs and that causes spread of the anesthetic agent in the airway passages. Then certain blocks will also be given, that is glossopharyngeal nerve block, superior laryngeal nerve block, to anesthetize the area of the oropharynx, posterior tongue and soft palate and area below the epiglottis. So this is superior laryngeal nerve block, which is given at the greater corneo of hyoid at the inferior border. And we tend to give 1 to 2 mL of a local anesthetic agent at the greater corneo of hyoid bone. Then glossopharyngeal nerve block, it can have extraoral or intraoral route. So most commonly intraoral route is used, where the anterior tonsillar pillar we give through a needle which is inserted at the base of the anterior tonsillar pillar, and 2 to 3 mL of local anesthetic agents to begin after negative aspiration. Again, a word about subventral intubation. We very commonly do it in our department because if the patient do have facial fractures and also other nasal pathology, nasal fractures or basis skull fractures or if CSF ranuria is here, then the nasal intubation or nasotracheal intubation is contraindicated or not advisable. Then we do subventral intubation. We normally intubate a patient orally. Then we take incision on the on the neck, just below the mandible, lateral to the midline, and forceps is the incision is increased and the dissected, and the forceps, sturdy forceps, is inserted to the base of to the floor of the mouth, and with the forceps we tend to extract the tube from the oral cavity into the submental space and outside, and then the anesthetic circuit can be attached to it. Again, a word about retromolar intubation. See how the retromolar space is, as we are seeing it in the photograph. The indication of retromolar intubation is if patient is having limited mouth opening, then that can be done with the fiber optic scope in the retromolar space. Or if the patient is having trauma which require the maxillary fixation, then we can do it. Then if there is a contraindication of a nasal intubation, like a basis skull fracture, so it can be act as an alternative to submental intubation, because submental intubation do have a risk of the fistula formation. And of course, if there's a CSF leak and a contraindication of the nasal intubation, we can do retromolar. And alternative tracheostomy with retromolar intubation can be used. A word about cricothyroid cannula and jet ventilation. This is a rescue strategy we used if intubation is very difficult and we cannot mass ventilate. Then the cricothyroid membrane is pierced with a needle and with a cannula, and the cannula is attached to the jet ventilation system, and the jets of the 100% oxygen can be given so as to ensure the oxygenation. Problem with the jet ventilation is only oxygenation can be done, but the ventilation is very poor. So patient tend to retain carbon dioxide because of poor ventilation. So this jet ventilation is not a permanent kind of rescue procedure, but that has to be followed by the definitive airway management, that is tracheostomy, to be done followed by jet ventilation. So now we are intubated. Now how to maintain the anesthesia? It can be done with inhalation or total intravenous anesthesia. Inhalation agent, that is we use oxygen, nitrous oxide and volatile anesthetic agent. So depending upon the patient's need and the patient's pain of anesthesia, that is the patient's heart rate, blood pressure, patient's ETCO2 and other parameters what we use, We try to just house the patient's plane of anesthesia, or the we can have the gas monitoring, so we can get the MAC values or the expired inhaled anesthetic agent on the monitor. And depending upon that and the clinical scenario, we tend to increase or decrease the anesthetic agent with the inhalational maintenance of anesthesia. It can also be maintained by total intravenous anesthesia, like we can use propofol, or opioids like remifentanil can be used. As we can use it along. We can use fentanyl also, but then it is having its own drawbacks. So the ideal agent of the TIVA would be remifentanil. And of course, along with this, for maintenance of anesthesia, nerve blocks is to be used by surgeons. Of course, it can have. It will aid in the post-op pain relief and also decrease the stress response. Then a word about hypotensive anesthesia. Why in maxillofacial surgery? Because these surgical fields are these tissues tend to bleed more. That could increase the operative time. That would increase the blood transfusion rate. So to decrease all that, the hypotensive anesthesia is used. So what are the prerequisite? Like the patient should not have major cardiovascular problems like coronary artery disease or uncontrolled hypertension or ischemic stroke or renal or hepatic impairment. These patients, it is risky because that will tend to decrease the tissue perfusion. So in normal patients where blood pressure is controlled or ASA 1 or 2 grade patients, we can use this hypotensive anesthesia. How it is to be used? The pharmacological and non-pharmacological methods are used. And how much to reduce the blood pressure? That is not more than 30% of the baseline mean arterial pressure. Or if you want to talk about systolic pressure can be decreased up to 80 to 90 mm of Hg, and mean arterial pressure not less than 55 mm of Hg. Because the vital organs like heart, brain, and kidneys do have their autoregulation. So the perfusion is maintained on the autoregulation range. So that range we need to maintain. So if we are not using at the higher range, but we should not cross the lower limits also, because then it would have a deleterious effect on the organ function and organ perfusion. So what are the pharmacological methods? It can be like the deepening of anesthesia if we are using inhalation agent, or intravenous agent, we can deep the plane of anesthesia, increasing the inhaled concentration of anesthetic, or increase the opioid doses and give good muscle relaxation. And other agents, what are other hypotensive agent can be used? I'll be talking about that in the next slide. What are non-pharmacological method? One is the head up position or positioning of the patient. So rising of the surgical area 1 centimeter will decrease the blood pressure of 0.77 mm of Hg. So if we give 10 degree tilt to the patient's head, then it will have 15 centimeter rise in the surgical area that will tend to fall the blood pressure of up to 11 mm of Hg. Then to decrease the blood loss, what we can do is normothermic hemodilution. Then to maintain the venous drainage of the head neck part. So to maintain the head in the neutral position so that there would not be undue pressure on the neck vessels, especially the venous drainage. Otherwise, it will have a venous ooze in the surgical field. Then certain antifibrillatic agents can be used like tranexamic acid. So what are the pharmacological methods? Inhalational agents, we already talked of. Then propofol can be used. It is short acting and rapid reversal of action. So propofol is very much advocated, and we are also using it as a hypotensive anesthetic agent. Then opioids of course can be used, because increase in analgesia will have a good surgical feel, because if the analgesia is good, then the hypertension, tachycardia won't be there. Then other agents like vasodilators, like nitroprusside or nitroglycerins can be used. Nitroglycerin is a venodilator mostly, and nitroprusside is a venoarterial dilator. So they do have very reliable hypotensive capacity. And it is these are very short acting. So if we turn off these agents, the hypotensive agent action would be abolished. A problem with these agents are it tend to have a tachyphylaxis. It can have reflex tachycardia. And with SMB or nitroglycerin, patient can have cyanide toxicity. So we need to see all these side effects also. And other agents we are using very much these days is the central alpha agonist, that is clonidine or dexmedetomidine. Dexmedetomidine we are using very much in common these days because they do have other effects like they tend to decrease blood pressure, they do have analgesia also, and they tend to have sedation. So the if the sedation and analgesia effect of these agents can decrease the requirement of other agents like inhalational agents. So they tend to augment the anesthetic effect. Problem with dexmedetomidine is bradycardia, patient can have bradycardia, severe hypertension can be there, and there could be rebound hypertension after stoppage of the infusion. Then other beta blockers can be used like labetalol or esomelol. The vasodilate, they tend to have the negative anatropic effect, that is the cardiac output is decreased. And other problem with beta blockers is it can have bronchospasm. But the good thing about labetalol and esomelol is these are very short acting. So we can infuse, we can put patient on infusion, and once the surgery is bleeding, we can off these infusions, and patient the reversal of hypertensive effect will have. So now we are having hypertensive anesthesia. So what are other intraoperative concerns in maxillofacial surgery? As the airway passages are shared and the mostly patient is under drape, so we should take care of eyes, eye protection, eye padding to be done. Then securing pressure areas, especially the prolonged surgeries, the ischemic ischial tuberosity or the heels or the elbows to be secured properly. Then the we should aware of the nerve injuries, like if the hyperextended hands or the certain prolonged procedures, patient can have no different nerve injuries like brachial plexus or ulnar nerves, and sciatic and comprehensive nerve injuries can happen. Then as the airway devices are under drapes, we should secure it properly. Then the oropharyngeal packing to be done to avoid the leaking into the oropharynx. Then to decrease the post-operative edema, dexamethasone is used many times. The monitoring of the vitals to be done throughout the period of surgery. Then maintain the adequate depth of anesthesia and analgesia to avoid tachycardia, hypertension, lacrimation, sweating. These are the some indications that patient is in the lighter plane of anesthesia. Then we also think about the maintain the fluid management properly. That is, we should consider the pre-existing losses, if, especially in the trauma patient or especially in the pediatric patient if they are having long period of NBM status, and intraoperative losses, that is blood losses or evaporative losses. If the evaporative losses when the large area of say in the cancer patient with the flap surgeries, if we are doing reconstructive surgeries, then large area, raw area is there. So evaporative losses could be up to 5 to 10 ml. Per kg per hour could be those losses. Those are to be considered and those are to be given properly. So for maintenance of the fluid, as I've been asked earlier also, how to calculate the baseline fluid requirement. So one simple formula is 4:1 formula. So any patient with any weight, say a 50 kg weight, so for first 10 kg, the fluid requirement will be 4 ml per kg. So for first 10 kg will be 40 ml. For next 10 kg, it is 2 ml per kg. So for 20 kg, it is 40 plus 20 ml. So it will be 60 ml per kg. And for rest of the weight, 1 ml per kg. So if you calculate like this, if 50, if say a patient is a 40 kg, so first 10 kg will be 40, second 10 kg will be 20, it is 60, and next 20 kg will be 20 ml. So the total baseline fluid requirement will be 80 ml per kg for that patient. So about the emergence and extubation, so we need to have certain things, checklist, that is discontinue the induced hypertension, then remove throat pack, proper suctioning, ensure hemostasis. We can extubate the patient in deep state or in awake state. So we our practice is generally the awake extubation. Then we need to see the proper neuromuscular block reversal, that is hand grip, sustained hand grip if the patient is having, or left head lift, adequate rate and depth of respiration, and a patient is having protective reflexes, that is cough and a gag reflex is present, then we can extubate the patient. Preferably in the lateral position, in a deep inspiration, we should extubate those patients. And followed that, patient should be propped up and O2 supplementation is to be given. So what could be postoperative complications? There are many, like if you enumerate, it could be most common would be postoperative residual sedation or confusion. It could be because of many reasons, could be drug, hypoxia, hyperkalemia, electrolyte imbalance, sepsis, or drug withdrawal, especially alcohol withdrawal. Or hypoxia or hypoventilation, it could be because of airway obstruction. So should put nasal or oral airways appropriately. Patient can have a hypoventilation, so because of drugs or because of obstruction, because these things are interdependent. So if hyperventilation, we can give assisted ventilation, we can give naloxone if it is a drug effect, or flumazenil if we need to reverse the benzodiazepines. Then patient can have weak ventilation perfusion mismatches that can be tackled with proper positioning, chest physiotherapies, CPAP, that is assisted ventilation, bronchodilators, and proper pain control. Then perfusion hypoxia, which is if we have used the nitrous oxide and we have extubated on nitrous oxide, then because of the rapid inflow of nitrous oxide in the alveoli, the patient can have hypoxia. So that can be tackled with high inspired oxygen concentration to be given. Then hypoxia can also be because of the low cardiac output state. Like if patient do have blood losses or fluid losses, then we need to replenish that. And a bad cardiovascular status, then we need to give inotropes also. The other major complication could be airway obstruction, especially in the maxillofacial surgeries. It could be tongue fall because of the muscle tone, or incomplete reversal of the muscle laxing, or because of secretions, because of foreign body, because of wound edema or soft tissue swelling. So airway obstruction to be sought for and to be tackled, like patient to be given these oral or nasal airways, or if incomplete reversal is there, then we should supplement it with the additional dose of reversal agent. And secretions of foreign body is there, then those are to be taken out. If the patient is of OSA, that is obstructive sleep apnea, then these patients do have the CPAP ventilators available. If they do have a home CPAP facility available, then that can be advocated in post-operative period. Then other hypertension or cardiac dysfunction or arrhythmias can be there in the post-operative complication. It can be because of various reasons. It could be because of arrhythmias, anaphylaxis. Most commonly, the hypovolemia and a residual effect of anesthetic agent, the hypertension is there. So that can be tackled with volume replacement and the reversal agents like naloxone or the benzodiazepines. Then post-operative hypothermia or shivering, especially in the prolonged surgeries, and if the surgery is done under general anesthesia, because general anesthesia, the hypothermia threshold is very much decreased, up to 2 to 4 degrees Celsius. So these patient under general anesthesia tend to cannot generate the heat, and the hypothermia can have other deleterious effect, bad effects on heart, on respiration, on platelet dysfunction, and other coagulation problems. Patient can have increased blood loss, and patient can have low cardiac output state. So these hypothermias to be sought of and to be corrected by active and passive rewarming of the patient. Then thromboembolism can be there because of prolonged surgery, especially in the cancer patients or in obese patient, pregnant patient, or patient on certain drugs like OC pills. So that can be tackled with thromboprophylaxis or compression stockings and early mobilization. And one of the very common problem with maxillofacial surgery is post-operative nausea and vomiting, especially if patient is female or there's an intraoperative opioid use, or there's a history of motion sickness, or nitrous oxide use is there, and also neostigmine if we are using as a reversal agent, then these patients tend to have an emetic effect. So if we have wired the jaws, then these wired cutters should be available near the patient, because otherwise patient can aspirate. The patient can have aspirate. So how to we can give these the dexamethasone is given generally to decrease the edema. The dexamethasone is having the antiemetic property. Propofol is also having antiemetic property. Other agents can be used like ondansetron or domperidone. That can be used as adjunct to the these agents like dexamethasone or propofol. Then when to like if these patients if they are having postoperative complication, these patients do we need tend to put this patient into the post seizure care unit. So when we'll certain scoring systems are there to see if the patient can be shifted to a general ward from the post anesthesia care units. So these are this is a one alert where we see activity, respiration, circulation, and consciousness and oxygen saturation. Depending upon the scores, we can advise patient either into the PACU itself or into the general wards. So to summarize post-operative management, we need to give patient supplemental oxygen, adequate pain control with opioid, NSAIDs or paracetamol. Then post-operative nausea vomiting is tackled with antiemetics. Then airway problems is to be continuously monitored for airway edema, hematoma, which may compress the neck. Patient need to be in ICU, HDU, depending upon the patient's condition, with the continuous monitoring. Many times invasive monitors is to be used. Then the dental wire cutters to be always present if the patient is wired. If the patient's airway is compromised, then continue intubation and we need to re-intubate the patient and continue the mechanical ventilation postoperatively. And blood loss is to be replaced, fluid and electrolyte supplementation in postoperative period, and nutrition supplementation, especially if the patient is wired if the patient's problem with the mouth opening is there, then we should put the rice tube in those patients, and this nutrition supplementation is to be really, because the post-operative recovery will also be depend upon the patient's nutrition status or nutrition supplements. So that's all from my side about the anesthetic part of the maxillofacial surgery. Thank you.
Thank you, Pallavi, for an excellent presentation. Very impressive.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I did well. I hope.
Alpana? I think I'll ask questions. Yes. Alpana comes in. There's one question which came up at the end. Maybe we'll start with that. You know, what is the choice of IV?
Choice of? Hello?
Yeah. Which IV fluid is better during GA? That is the question from Dr. Suraj.
Okay. Actually, for short seizure, it doesn't make much difference. We can use normal saline, we can use ringer lactate, we can use balancol, we can use these near plasma-like solutions. If the procedure is shorter, so it doesn't make sense. But if the procedure is long and we tend to use one type of IV fluid, that is say we tend to use the normal saline very much, then because of the increase in the chloride concentration in normal saline, patient can have these hyperchloremic metabolic acid disease. Especially if we tend to give 3 liters, 4 liters of normal saline, if there is ongoing blood loss, we just push the fluid so much. So for such patient, we can alternate between the normal saline and ringer lactate. But the answer to this question is there is no definite one fluid is better than other. I won't say. I mean, it's not very hard and fast. But for shorter procedure, anything would be advisable. Only thing regarding the dextrose containing fluid, we cannot give this dextrose containing fluid as a bolus doses, because patient can have these hyperglycemic diuresis. Other thing would be that tend to increase the blood sugar level, because already as a stress, surgical stress, the patient sugars are on a higher side. only indication of dextrose containing fluid would be diabetic patient whose blood sugars are below 200 and we are giving ongoing insulin infusions. Then to avoid hypoglycemia infusion, we do give dextrose containing fluid. And of course in a pediatric patients, very small pediatric patient, we tend to give these dextrose containing fluid. Otherwise, a normal adult patient, no need of giving dextrose fluid.
Alpana, I think you have some questions.
There's somebody who wanted you to throw some light on anesthetic, the workstation that is used in the...
Okay. So the anesthetic workstation is where, it's a modern terminology used for these high-end anesthetic machines, where we do have, in addition to the gas flows and anesthetic delivery system, the inhalation anesthetic delivery system, we do have the monitoring system as well. The monitoring of patients. So we need not to have a separate monitor for the patient, but the workstation do come with the monitor system, that is the right from the pulse oximeter, ECGs, non-invasive blood pressures to end-tidal CO2s, and also invasive blood pressure monitoring. Even certain workstations, especially in certain kind of surgeries like cardiovascular surgeries, they do have these cardiac output monitoring system also. And other thing is the depth of anesthesia monitoring system can also be incorporated into those monitors, like the BIS monitor, that is bispectral index, which would give us the rough idea about the how the patient is, the depth is how much. In addition to that, we have the spirometer available, that is we do get the real-time monitoring of the patient's tidal volume, expirated tidal volume, inspirated tidal volume, patient's airway pressures. Many ideas can be many information we get from these spirometry data, that is if airway pressures are more, then it could be a tube king or secretions, or it can be a say pulmonary edema or some pneumothoraxes. We can get ideas about on from the spirometry. I said about a gas monitoring. In addition to the anesthetic gas, we can get the real-time values of the inspired oxygen concentration, expired oxygen concentration, inspired carbon dioxide concentration, expired carbon dioxide concentration, because they do have these gas analyzers. They use the spectrometry or these infrared spectrometry, various different modalities are used, and we tend to have information about gases, patients' vital status, patients' respiratory data. So these everything incorporated into one workstation, that is the anesthesia workstation. Yeah, I hope I have made it a little more clear.
Alpana, you have more questions, I think.
Somebody who's asking for the steps in nasal intubation.
Test in nasal intubation?
Steps. The various steps that you have to follow.
Steps. Yeah. Okay. So, nasal intubation, we do it very commonly, almost daily. One thing I will advise is, we need to see, especially many a times the patient can have these deviated nasal septum. So, one thing what we can do preoperatively is a spatula test. That is called steel spatula. We can put it in front of the nose and we see where is the fogging taking place. So that nostril is patent, it would suggest. Other thing is that the patent nostril will be a little roomy. Then before nasal intubation, we should, especially in children, we should see if there are no adenoids there, or the history of snoring is not there in pediatric population. Otherwise, these adenoids tend to bleed. Then, before induction, we should put these nasal decongestant, that is these oxymetazoline or otrivin drops, so as these should not bleed. Earlier, when I was in our residency, what we used to do is we used to put a one or two size smaller red rubber plain tube through the nostril we are going to use so that to make a passage for the subsequent tube we will be using, because if we are using a cuff tube, then the cuff tube tend to have the area where the cuff is, then the diameter would be more. So again, if you are using just the cuff tube at point of entry, then again that tend to bleed. So earlier we used to lubricate the plain red rubber tube of a smaller size, and we try to create a passage through the nose. And then after induction, whatever desired tube we want to use, we use it outrightly afterwards. Then these preformed tube will have the extra length. But if you are using normal tube, then they do have two different markings, that is oral and the nasal. So if you are using nasal, then the markings we should see. Otherwise, the tube could be the cuff. May not be there beyond the glottic opening, and the cuff could be anywhere into the oropharynx, and it will have its own problems afterwards. So, and after nasal intubation, especially patient, we need to keep the head in the extension position so that to align the nasal passages with the glottic opening. And visually also we can see the the tube entering to the glottic opening from the anterior side of the neck. And of course the intubation can be confirmed by the bilateral air entry and of course the end-tidal CO2 confirmation.
Alpana, before you ask the next question, we have Dr. Abhay Datarkar, professor and head of the department, who has joined in, and Dr. Sharan Japati, renowned maxillofacial surgeon from Dhule, and he has appreciated your talk very much. So thank you. There are more questions, I think. Sorry, Alpana.
There's one more here. My PGs here want to know what is the positive pressure ventilation. Can you throw light on that? Ventilation.
Okay. Though all the ventilators what we are having is a positive pressure ventilation. To start the history of ventilators, earlier days when the days only to start with, the ventilatory management was a negative pressure ventilation. That is, we tend to put the patient in the box, create a vacuum, and then the atmospheric pressure will drive the gas inside the patient's lung. This was the earlier days. But now what we do is we increase the pressure. The driving pressure will be more than the atmospheric pressure. And the difference between, because say at the end of expiration, the pressure into our alveoli will be of the atmospheric pressure. So with positive pressure ventilation, the compressor in the ventilator will have a positive pressure from well above the atmospheric pressure, and that difference of pressure will take the gas inside the alveoli. Especially, this is very technical about ventilator, but I like to add one thing about the OSA patients, where they do have these CPAP or the home CPAP machines, where because of the obstruction, the air cannot go inside and patient is in sleep. So he cannot exert the forces so much that there would be air flow. So what the CPAP machine does is they increase the pressure of the inhaled gases. So the pressure will be that much where it can overcome the obstruction, and the gas flow will be there. So the bottom line is the positive pressure ventilation is the driving gas will be of pressure which will be more than the atmospheric pressure. What our normal respiration is, we do have these, we inspire this, the gas or the atmospheric air by creating negative pressure in the pleural cavity. So our normal respiration is a negative pressure ventilation, but the ventilation is from the ventilator, it is positive pressure. Thank as you. Compared to
Alpana?
Yeah, I've done Rama. I mean,
okay, there was a few questions which I would like to ask with Alpana's permission. Is isolite, can isolite M be used for introp as maintenance fluid? Isolite M.
Isolite M, if I think it do, yeah, that can see basically what the IV fluid intraoperatively, it should have the composition of that fluid should be as close as the our normal blood composition. That is, the sodium should be of a range of what we are having normal sodium, or the chloride range should be of, so sodium range should be between 135, 140, or the chloride should be around 90. Then the bicarbonate should be around, say, 20, 24. Then potassium around 5. So the fluids which we are using, if it is having iso osmolar concentration or iso electrolyte concentration of what our plasma is having, then it should be a good fluid intraoperatively. Unless patient do have certain electrolyte electrolyte imbalances, then we need, tend to use certain specialized fluid. But I think intraoperatively, normal saline or Ringel lactate, well enough. And isolite, I would like to throw light on isolite P, especially in the pediatric population, because the sodium load, they cannot tolerate. So the isolate P do have the lower sodium concentration and their potassium requirement is higher. So the isolate P do have more potassium as compared to a normal, say, RL or normal saline. So we tend to give this isolate P, these pediatric population. But as long as, I think nothing is very much ideal than, you know, I mean, I cannot compare things as long as surgery is a very short procedure.
A big honor for us is that Dr. Ashok Dabir, a very, very senior maxillofacial surgeon from Mumbai, has joined. He's a legend in the field of maxillofacial surgery. Welcome, Dabir sir, to our series. I always see you. It's a great encouragement for all of us. The next question is, what is your view on monoamine oxidase inhibitors and GA, MAO?
Yes. These MAO inhibitors, especially a patient with some psychiatric or depressive psychosis, these patients, these agents, what they do is, these MAO enzyme, that is monoamine oxidase enzyme, they try to decrease the metabolism, or the breakdown of these catecholamines is inhibited because of these. And especially in surgical stress, where there is an increase in the sympathetic activity, and other thing is, if we are using these adrenaline infiltration, and as these enzyme is inhibited, the patient can have the increased level of catecholamines, and that can cause hypertension and tachycardia and the associated sympathetic overactivity, and that will have a deleterious effect. So ideally, these MAO inhibitors are to be stopped at least 3 to 4 weeks prior to the surgery, if the patient is on, so as to avoid these complications. And of course, the MAO inhibitors is not very, not very much in use, because other safer agents are used these days for these psychiatric illnesses, like SSRIs or TPAs. SSRI is very much in use. So we don't actually come across such situations, but this is a theoretical interaction. The inotropes, which what we are using, if we are using these, we should use the inotrope at all. We need to use the directly acting, not indirectly acting inotropes. Indirectly acting will increase the catecholamine production, and then indirectly they act. So that can also have a deleterious effect of hypertension, tachycardia, and sympathetic activity. Yeah.
Okay. There is one question that, is there any objective assessment as to when the patient comes out of anesthesia? I mean, how would you assess that the patient is?
Yes. As the end of a surgery, as we are if we tend to decrease the, or tend to stop the agents, like inhalation agents, or if we are giving intravenous agents, we tend to stop all those. and we can give patients 100, we can off the nitrous oxide also, give 100% oxygen. So how to objectively see is to, patient can have the respiratory attempts. We can see it on the entitled CO2 graph, or we can see it on the bag if the patient is attempting respiratory efforts, or we can see it on the spirometry data, spirometry graph. As the positive pressure ventilation will have the graphs above the baseline, but if our respiration is negative pressure ventilation, so we can get this small deflection below baseline, so as to suggest the negative pressures in the breathing system. So this is one, the respiratory efforts. Second is, as we are discontinuing the anesthetic agents, patient can have tachycardia, patient can have hypertension, patient can have increase in if the patient is tachypneic, then patient, the entitled CO2 would be on a lower side, then patient can have some movements of the extremities. We can see the reflexes, like that is swallowing reflex or a gag, patient can like show, or patient can cough on the tube. And how to assess for the adequate neuromuscular reversal is to see for the sustained, we can ask the patient if he can hold the hand, sustain hand lift for 5 seconds, or sustain head lift for 5 seconds. Or we can objectively quantify it by using the neuromuscular monitoring. So depending upon the information we can get from that, we can say the patient is out of the muscle relaxation, that is adequate depth of respiration, adequate rate of respiration. Patient should be conscious, like he should follow commands, at least, I mean, if not opening eyes, at least he should follow commands, airway reflexes, breathing efforts.
Last question. What's the role of calcium and sodium bicarbonate in long-term anesthesia when complete neuromuscular control is not regained after GA? Role of calcium and sodium bicarbonate.
Bicarbonate, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, one about sodium, about these bicarbonates, especially I would advocate if the patient do have, if it's a prolonged surgery, there is episodes of hypotension or blood loss or cardiovascular instability, then these patients do have metabolic acidosis. And the metabolic acidosis tend to potentiate the neuromuscular blockers. Or the metabolism of these drugs would be hampered because of the because the acidosis is more, then the perfusion of the organs will be less. So in prolonged surgeries where patient is unstable, of course we can objectively see it on the ABGs, but if we don't have that in our setup, then depending on the patient's clinical status, that is if patient is hypothermic, or blood pressure is on the lower side, tachycardic, and if urine output is low, then yes, we tend to give bicarbonates in those patients. So as to augment the blood flow, augment blood BP, maintain the acid-base balance, and then we can assume that the metabolism will be good and reversal would be better in those patients. But actually, it's very vague to say that, because we do have objective, we can have objective evidences. I mean, giving bicarbonates blindly would be, I won't advocate, because we can always see is on the neuromuscular monitors, or we can always see the clinical parameters. So unless a patient is very bad intraoperatively, I usually don't give. Other thing about calcium is, I don't think so, because the muscle relaxant what we are using is, it has nothing to do with calcium. Actually, it's just the competitive blockade at the neuromuscular junction. So it just, the muscle relaxant blocks the acetylcholine to act on the receptor and to have further neural transmission. So only thing I would say, calcium, not to reverse the neuromuscular blockade, but only thing if there's a massive blood loss and then if you have transfused the blood massively, then only I can think of. Otherwise, calcium, routinely, I don't advocate. I haven't used also.
Rama, you got a question?
Yeah, I have one. This is the very last question, actually. But before that, we would like Dabir sir to, as usual, say a couple of words to which will act as motivation for us. Dabir sir, a few words.
Hello. Good afternoon. Ma'am, you're making a wonderful presentation, and in our branch, you know, anesthesiology plays a major role, of course, in any surgery. But you are conversant with our procedures, and intubation is always a hassle, and we guys do submental and all that, then they awake intubation. But I think you have already discussed all those issues. But thank you. I've joined late. I have nothing to say. But I think, you know, I will just quote one. My teacher, Dr. K.S. Goleria, plastic surgeon, what he used to say was, learn to be a good assistant to an anesthesiologist. Don't try to be an anesthesiologist. If you do a good, whenever there's intubation, extubation, stand by, be present with the anesthesiologist. Thank you, my dear Rama. Thanks for remembering me.
Thank you, sir. Pallavi, can you stop sharing, please? Because we'd like to do some, yeah.
Okay, let's see.
It will be on the top side.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Is it okay now?
Yeah, absolutely. Abhilasha?
Yes, sir.
We are having a very, these are wonderful sessions which the CIM is bringing to you. Today is the 20th one, this 8th in season 2 and 12th in season 1. And we would continue to do so in the future. So thanks to the efforts of everyone. Thanks to all those who joined. And we are going to come up with something very, very exclusive. Possibly nobody has done it before. But we believe that ladies should be empowered to the maximum. And that is why Abhilasha is showing her niece's photograph.
Sorry, sir. My mistake.
So this is the ladies' week that begins from 5th and that goes till the 10th. And we have a bonanza, absolutely fantastic speakers and moderators. So please do join us from 5th. 5th is an evening, 5th, that is Sunday, it's at 4 o'clock. Details would be put up by tomorrow. And tomorrow's speaker is Dr. Kshitij Bang, who's going to speak on ZMC fractures. Sir, we need you in all these webinars. Kabir sir, your presence is much needed always.
My God, I'm honored. I'll try. Thank
sir.
You, Rama.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
So, thank you very much. Abhilasha, I would like to... I would like to do my task. Our speakers have been absolutely fantastic, and Dr. Pallavi is no exception to that. This is a small token of appreciation from us. Kindly accept this certificate, Dr. Pallavi. It will be sent to you by WhatsApp or email. And Dr. Rajashree, I find it very difficult to say Dr. Rajashree because all this while I've been
here.
So that is what I said.
Rama.
Sir, Dabir sir, in the beginning I said, what's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. So that holds good for Alpana. Whether she's Alpana or Rajashree, she is absolutely fantastic as a surgeon, as a mother, as a clinician.
Great.
Two names, yeah. Thank you.
You're right, Rama. You're right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, so we see everybody tomorrow. And thank you so much for joining.
Can I come in, Dr. Shenon?
Yes, Varsha, please.
Yeah, I would like to appreciate Pallavi madam. She has done a fantastic job. She has presented very nicely all the aspects of general anesthesia. She's an asset in our department. Since 5 years she's with us, and all the difficult intubation cases and all general anesthesia cases she's handling. And the same knowledge she has shared with everyone. I appreciate Pallavi. And thank you to all participants, especially Dabir sir, to join such a topic. Thank you, Dabir sir.
I'm sorry I'm late.
Sir, I must let you know that this was a topic which came as a feedback. We had done a asked for a feedback. So they said that they want something on general anesthesia and Dr.
Very, very true. Very important. Absolutely important.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, everybody. We are honored. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank
bye.
You, sir. Bye. Thank you so much, sir. Bye-bye, sir.
Bye.
Bye.
मीटिंग
ये वाला वेबिनार
प्रेजेंटेशन